Well, good morning to each of you. God's grace and peace be with you on this day, this third Sunday in Advent, in which we celebrate the gift of joy, the joy that comes in Jesus. I want to make a few announcements for us as points of celebration. Did you know that this last week, yes, we were able to sponsor 150 children with the Angel Tree Ministry? And so great job, church. We're so thankful that you all stepped forward and said yes to that in caring for kids, because all kids truly are our kids. We're one big human family. And so we give thanks for that. Upcoming services here for Christmas, 2, 4, 6, and 8, 2 o'clock online, 4, 6, and 8 at Grace. And so we hope that you'll be able to find a place there at one of those in which to worship. And if it's here online, we'll be streaming it at 2, but of course you can join in anytime after that, whatever fits your family and holiday schedule as you gather for Christmas over these next few days. And so may God bless you in this Christmas season as we journey together. And as we move toward year end, we remind about year end giving so that we can continue our ministry like this, bringing worship online and doing all the things that God has called us to. You can give through gotgrace.com or, of course, by mailing that gift to the church. All those gifts for year end giving need to be in by December 31st. Well, with that, we're going to begin in a word of prayer so that we can dive deep into this worship today. Let us pray. Gracious Lord Jesus, we give you thanks for this morning, another time to pause, to reflect, and to be present with you. Yes, God, pour down that gift of joy. We need joy, joy in abundance, laughter and love, celebrations. Even they may be tinged with moments of sadness and grief and all of those other things that come at us in this world. But may the seed of joy be planted deep, and may it spring up from within each of us. And may that joy point back to you from where all our good gifts come. Again, God, we're so thankful to be able to worship together. We pray in Jesus' name, and God's people say, Amen.
first reading, Micah chapter 5, lines 2 through 5. But you, O Bethlehem of Ephrathah, who are one of the little clans of Judah, from you shall come forth for me one who is to rule in Israel, whose origin is from of old, from ancient days. Therefore he shall give them up until the time when she who is in labor has brought forth. Then the rest of the kindred shall return to the people of Israel. And he shall stand and feed his flock in the strength of the Lord, in the majesty of the name of the Lord his God. And they shall live secure. For now he shall be great to the ends of the earth, and he shall be one of peace. If the Assyrians come into our land,
if the Assyrians come into our land,
and tread upon our soil,
and tread upon our soil,
we will rise against them seven shepherds.
We will rise against them seven shepherds.
And eight installed as rulers.
And eight installed as rulers.
Gospel reading, Luke chapter 1, 39 through 55.
In those days Mary set out and went with haste to a Judean town in the hill country, where she entered the house of Zechariah and greeted Elizabeth.
When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the child leapt in her womb. And Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit and exclaimed with a loud cry, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. And why has this happened to me, that the mother of my Lord comes to me? For as soon as I heard the sound of your greeting, the child in my womb leaped for joy. And blessed is she who believed that there would be a fulfillment of what was spoken to her by the Lord."
My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices with God my Savior. He has looked with favor and lowliness for his servant. Surely from now on all generations will call me blessed. For the Mighty One has done great things for me, and holy is his name. His mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the power of their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, according to the promise he made our ancestors to Abraham and to his descendants forever.
My soul sings out to the Lord. My heart exclaims the work of God, my deliverer. For God has seen the status of God's lowly servant, and rightly, from this time forward, all the generations will see that I was blessed. For the Great One has done magnificent things through me, and I call upon the mystery of God's name. God's mercy is for those who honor God from generation to generation. God has shown the hand of justice by scattering the proud, humbling their haughty thoughts. God has brought down the powerful from their high places and lifted up all the lowly. God has filled the hungry with God's plenty and sent away the wealthy with empty hands. God has helped God's servant, Israel, to remember God's rich mercy in accordance to the covenant made to our ancestors, to Abraham, and to his children forever.
My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God. Incredible witness and incredible words in our much beloved scripture passage this morning. Mary's Magnificat is certainly powerful enough to stand alone, and how much more impactful is it with those images we just shared, we just witnessed in our worship video? God has brought down the powerful and lifted up the lowly, has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. I've loved this passage for longer than I can remember, but certainly from the time that I first realized that Mary's words were the inspiration behind one of my favorite parts of Holden Evening Prayer, an end-of-day liturgy that our community and our congregation has used often. The song that goes, and forgive me my singing, but the song that goes, my soul proclaims your greatness, O God, and my spirit rejoices in you. That song gets its lyrics from this passage. An uplifting song of praise, its major chords and lilting melody immediately lift spirits and encourage its singers and listeners alike. And that's exactly what it's supposed to do. What I don't think it does quite as well is inspire anyone to vote, to protest, to march, or to speak out against the powers of the world that work against God's dream of life, prosperity, freedom, and choice for all of God's creation. Mary's words, these are much more than a heart-warming lullaby. I didn't even really want to preach today because Mary, she's got it covered. Mary, a young girl from a backwoods town, pregnant out of wedlock, part of an ethnic minority, oppressed and ruled over by the Romans, engaged to a carpenter, this Mary. She's got more to say about God's activity in the world than I will have to say over a lifetime. This reality that Mary speaks of is a reversed reality, a change in the societal reality around us. In her words and witness, Mary shares with us her lived experience of God caring about our social realities. God cares about the world so much that God is willing to wade into that place that so many of us are scared to go. God enters into and is active in political spheres. God speaks about politics. Politics, after all, are simply our structuring of our society, how we've agreed to live together, how we arrive at those decisions, how we live with those decisions, and the ramifications of that structuring is when we so often run into things like corruption, misuse of power, and all those things that have made us weary of engaging with or talking about politics. But these words of Mary's, they're like a jolt to the spirit for all of those who have grown weary and disillusioned with the ways that humans have tried and failed over and over to get that world structuring right. And we still don't have it right. Mary's words also speak to a reversal of salvation, another reversal we haven't totally figured out yet. On a personal level, we're told every day we are what we make ourselves to be. If we aren't where we want to be, we simply need to pick ourselves up and do it. Make it happen. And if you don't quite get there on your own, well, there's a new makeup that will make it happen, or a new formula of weight loss science that will change it all. That idea, the idea of just pick yourself up and do it, is at the basis of the American dream. A dream that at its best is beautiful and is all about what is possible, but can also be corrupted by human failing. Because we can already see the flaws in that argument, can't we? If the life we want isn't happening in this logical area, in this logical argument, then who is to blame? It must mean I don't want it bad enough. It must mean I haven't worked hard enough. It must mean there's something wrong with me. What this doesn't take into account are things like systemic oppression, things that would stop someone from achieving the life they want purely because of the skin they're in, purely because of who they love, purely because of the country where they were born. All of these things impact our ability to just pick ourselves up. It's never that easy. It is never that easy. Now, communally, we learn to listen to the powerful. We listen to politicians and celebrities and influencers and those who speak with bravado and confidence. And we so often from those voices hear themes of tribalism, nationalism, us-them language, fear and anxiety. And so often, we listen to those who are saying what we already know. Into this chaos, into this wrongness of reality, enters Mary's Magnificat, a song of praise, a song of prophecy. This isn't a sweet lullaby. It's nothing short of true prophecy, a prophecy of salvation by reversal. Our individual salvation is no longer dependent on what we do. Through Christ, we are saved by nothing we've done. Our communal salvation will no longer come from the powerful and God's new world order. We will see the kingdom come about through voices that shake, voices that have been told they don't matter, voices that have been systemically silenced, voices that have not been welcome at the table. Mary's prophecy speaks to a social, political, cosmic reality that is exactly as God dreamed it to be. Mary's words speak to us out of a context over 2,000 years ago, and yet she could have spoken them this morning. We are still waiting on this reversal of society, still waiting for God's dream to be realized. And at the exact same time, in those 2,000 years, this prophecy has been fulfilled over and over and over again. Now, humor and bear with me here for a second while we dive into a little bit of English and Greek vocabulary. I know, everyone's favorite topic, but I promise it'll be worth it. English teachers and Greek scholars, please forgive me because I'm no expert, but this part of our scripture reading is just too good to pass up. When Mary claims that God has brought down the powerful, has lifted up the lowly, has filled the hungry, and has sent the wealthy away empty, the verbiage in this passage can play havoc on our understanding of time in relation to the prophecy. Combining has with a past tense verb, like lifted, creates a present perfect tense. This tense is used to describe an action that was completed prior to the present. It has already happened. So in Mary's prophecy in English, she's claiming, and rightfully so, that God has already done these things. Any God who's already done all this is certainly worthy of a song of praise. But that verb in Greek complicates the prophecy's relation to time even further. In Greek, this verb is a nomic aorist verb. I'm going to say that again. It's a nomic, like little troll gnomes, nomic aorist verb. Aorist verbs described events in the past tense, which go along with our English translation and understanding of this passage. But nomic verbs are something else entirely. Nomic verbs were considered neutral, are considered neutral verbs because they exist outside the bounds of time. They did not need a past, present, or future form of the verb because they were understood as ongoing. They were not bound by time. Which is by far the most incredible part of Mary's prophecy, I think. In her verb choice alone, Mary is claiming that God has already done this. And at the exact same time, God continues to do this, to work in this way. God's ongoing relationship with the world means that this action on God's part has happened already, is actively happening all around us, and will continue happening throughout all of time. And all of that is witnessed and praised by a young girl from an oppressed minority facing further oppression because of the child she carries, speaking to us out of the bounds of time itself. this action, this movement of God, just like we were talking last week, this movement of always moving towards us. This action is ongoing and never ending. This action we are invited to participate in this week and always. Our call from Mary is to be active participants, active co-authors, active co-creators of God's dream for all creation. Her song reminds us that God is actively dismantling the systems, both within us and between us, that prioritize and privilege some while oppressing others. Her witness reminds us that God is actively seeking out partners in that dismantling work, just like he sought out Mary as a co-creator, as a partner, as a co-conspirator in this reorganizing, in this reversal of society. This Christmas, may we be set on fire, not lulled into inaction, but set ablaze as co-creators. May we hear in our very bones the call across the centuries to be co-conspirators with the Holy Spirit. May we live into the already and the not yet of God's vision for us all. Amen.
My soul cries out with a joyful shout. The God of my heart is great, and my spirit sings of the wondrous things you bring to the one who waits. You fix your sight on the servant's plight, and my weakness you did not spurn. So from east to west shall my name be blessed. Could the world be about to turn? Though high and small, my God, my all, you work great things in me, and your mercy will last from the depths of the past to the end of the age to be. Your very name puts the crowd to shame, and those who would bore you yearn. You will show your might, put the strong to flight, for the world is about to turn. My heart shall sing of the day you bring. Let the fires of your justice burn. Wipe away all tears, for the dawn draws near, and the world is about to turn. From the halls of power to the fortress tower, not a stone will be left on stone. Let the king be with you. Your justice tears every tyrant from his throne. The hungry poor shall weep no more for the food they can never earn. Is our table spread, every mouth be fed, for the world is about to turn. From age to age, we remember who holds us fast. God's mercy must deliver us from the conqueror's crushing grasp. This saving word that our forebears heard is the promise that holds us bound. Till the spear and rod be crushed by God, who is turning the world. My heart shall sing of the day you bring. Let the fires of your justice burn. Wipe away.
away all tears, for the dawn draws near, and the world is about to turn.
Amen. Well, we hope that in your home you have some candles that you've been lighting as you've been preparing the way of the Lord, paying attention to how God's speaking in your life. Today in our home, we lit the joy candle, the pink candle that we have as part of our Advent wreath. The kids put these all together at Sunday school at Grace. A beautiful kit for each of them to have so they could each have their way of expressing thanks to God and listening to God. So again, we light that candle of joy, true joy that is found in Christ. Let that light shine in all of the issues and concerns of our world. Well, now we turn to communion, where we know that Jesus called the disciples and he called the community, the world, to follow into the way of life. And Jesus, I think, did that with an abundance of joy. From wedding banquets and various celebrations, from teaching on a seashore, even post-resurrection to coming back and say, hey guys, fish on the other side of the boat, to which then they bring in nets full. I think Jesus had a lot of love and laughter, a lightness about his step that he would take as he shared all about God, knowing that the world would often reject it, but that yet that offering and that gift of life, that it would still be there because of who God created him to be, how God sent him into the world as a vulnerable Christ child and one who would die and be raised up for all. And so that's why we pause to do communion and to do communion in this way online. And so in the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. And again, after supper, he took the cup, blessed it, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me. I invite you to join me in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now receiving these gifts, taking the bread or whatever it is that you have there ready in your home, body of Christ given for you. Blood of Christ shed for you. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in God's joy, now and forever. Amen. Oh, pray that you have been filled to full life today through worship. Now go out and share that blessing with others. And invite others to join you in this space. Always join us on the chat feature as well, sharing prayer concerns, ministry needs, things that are bringing you life, to keep us more connected into community. And as we say, we'll see you around the church of God together. So receive this benediction. May you live within the light of love in these coming days. May love call forth the songs that you sing. May love enliven your celebrations. May love be within you. And may love surround you. May you know, deeply know, the abundance of God's steadfast love. And God's people say, Amen. Go in peace to serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.